Penguin Random House Audio presents City of Saints, A Pilgrimage to John Paul II's Kraków by George Weigel. Read for you by Stefan Rudnicki. Down through all generations, the words of Christ echo and resound along with the witness of the gospel, Christian culture, and the customs that derive from faith, hope, and charity. Can one cast all this off? Can one say no? Can one refuse Christ and all that he has brought into human history? Certainly not. One time Christ asked the apostles, "Do you too wish to go away?" John 6:67. Allow the successor of Peter, before all of you gathered here today, to repeat the words of Peter, which constituted his reply to Christ's question. "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life." John 6:68. Pope John Paul II, Homily on the Kraków Commons, June 10, 1979. Kraków. St. John Paul II and the city where the 20th century happened. When 18-year-old Karol Josef Wojtyła, newly arrived in Kraków from provincial Wadowice, walked across the Dębniki Bridge and into Kraków's old town in the fall of 1938 to register for his first classes in Polish language and literature at the Jagiellonian University, he may already have felt a sense of kinship with the ancient city that had been Poland's cultural capital for centuries. He had read deeply in his country's poetry, its plays, and its novels. He was a patriot who had begun to grasp the unique role that Poland's culture had played in its singular history. He was a committed Catholic in a city that had given the church several saints. In moving to Kraków with his widower father, he was, in a sense, moving home. Still, neither he, his father, those who would become his teachers, nor the men and women who would become his friends, imagined that this 20-minute walk past the site of the martyrdom of St. Stanisław and the great hill of Wawel, with its royal castle and cathedral, was in fact the first moment in a lifelong pilgrimage during which Karol Wojtyła, as Pope John Paul II, would bring a Krakowian sensibility to the world, and in doing so would bend the curve of history in a more humane direction, while leaving an indelible impression on the life and thought of the Catholic Church. To follow Karol Wojtyła through Kraków is to follow an itinerary of sanctity while learning the story of a city. Thus, in what follows, the story of Karol Wojtyła, St. John Paul II, and the story of Kraków are interwoven in a chronological pilgrimage through the life of a saint that reveals at the same time the richly textured life of a city where a boy grew into a man, a priest, a bishop, and an apostle to the world. Crossroad. Kraków's Rynek Główny, the main market square at the heart of the old city, is the greatest public space in Europe, rivaled only by the Piazza San Marco in Venice for size, architectural achievement, and decorative splendor. To walk through this magnificent example of urban development is to traverse one of the principal crossroads of Europe, in the very heart of Europe. For Poles have never thought of themselves as a part of Eastern Europe. Poland is in Central Europe, and the center of Poland, its history and culture, is Kraków. From the late 14th century to the early 17th, during more than 200 years of growth initiated by the marriage of the young Polish queen Jadwiga to the Lithuanian Grand Duke Władysław Jagiełło, the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, with its capital in Kraków, was one of the great powers of Europe. Second only to France in size, it eventually governed a vast expanse of territory, reaching from the Baltic in the north to the Black Sea in the south, and from the German Länder immediately to the west to the hinterlands of Moscow in the east. Leaving Kraków's royal castle as the Ottoman Turks closed in on Vienna in 1683, King Jan III Sobieski and the famed Polish heavy cavalry, the Winged Hussars, decisively defeated the last great armed Islamic invasion of Europe. Something of Sobieski's temper and Poland's and Kraków's can be gleaned from the message, a striking variant on Julius Caesar's, sent by the victorious Polish monarch to Pope Innocent XI, along with the green banner of Muhammad captured from the Ottoman Grand Vizier. Veni, vidi, Deus vincit. I came, I saw, God conquered. Kraków was far more than the chief city of a great political military power, however. For the old Polish royal capital was and is located on the border between Europe's two wings, the Latin West and the Byzantine East. That location is reflected in the city's striking combination of architectural styles, in which the visitor frequently finds elaborate Baroque decoration inside churches crowned with onion domes reminiscent of classic Orthodox church architecture. Here, in addition to the Latin that was the common tongue of educated people, the local citizens spoke a Slavic language written in the Latin alphabet, another sign that Kraków and Poland were a bridge across traditional cultural divides. Here, during the European Wars of Religion, a tradition of civility, tolerance, and respect for the rights of conscience was the accepted public norm. There were no religious persecutions in Reformation-era Kraków, no coerced conversions, no burning of heretics. In 1583, Poland's political leaders made a declaration of tolerance, the likes of which could be found nowhere else in Europe. We who differ in matters of religion will keep the peace among ourselves and neither shed blood on account of differences of faith or kinds of church, nor punish one another by confiscation of goods, deprivation of honor, imprisonment, or exile. Poles and Krakowians were not angels, and intolerance certainly warped individual lives. But the public norm was tolerance. It was embodied in the famous declaration of King Zygmunt II August to the Polish Parliament, the Sejm, that I am not the king of your consciences. And as historian Norman Davies once put it, Poland was a land without bonfires, while much of the rest of Europe self-destructed in the 30 Years' War. At the height of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, Kraków was also a major commercial and intellectual metropolis. In the Rynek Główny, one could hear a multitude of tongues spoken, buy and sell products from across Europe, plan commercial expeditions to far lands and distant shores. Kraków's economic vitality and the generosity of wealthy Poles helped support one of Europe's greatest centers of scholarship in the middle of the second millennium, a tradition of learning dating back to the Middle Ages, when intellectually adventurous students from this part of the world traveled the long road to Paris to study under Thomas Aquinas. The Jagiellonian University, which was once sustained by the philanthropy of Queen Jadwiga, grew out of the Kraków Academy of Theology and gave Kraków, Poland, the Catholic Church, and the world both saints and men of genius. Jan Kanti, a late medieval biblical scholar canonized in 1767. Mikołaj Kopernik, Copernicus, who changed the world's view of the world's place in the universe. And Paweł Włodkowicz, who at the Council of Constance in 1414 inveighed against the Teutonic Knights and their practice of conversion by conquest. Located above the Vistula River on a rocky promontory at the southern edge of today's Old City, standing watch over Kraków, is Wawel Hill, the Polish Zion. Wawel's royal castle and cathedral, a complex of structures woven together over centuries, draws one's gaze upward, evoking the great aspirations that made and make Kraków unique. The city ceased to be Poland's political capital in 1596, when King Zygmunt III moved the seat of government to Warsaw. Yet for almost half a millennium, Kraków, no longer a center of political power, has remained the cultural and spiritual capital of Poland. Today, the Polish Zion looks over a thriving city at the very center of Europe. A city under pressure. When Poland, the state, was erased from the map of Europe by the Third Polish Partition of 1795, a vivisection conducted by the neighboring great powers of Russia, Prussia, and Austria, Kraków remained one of the great centers of Polish national consciousness. And for a century and a quarter, the years Poles referred to as their national time on the cross, Kraków's literary, intellectual, and religious life all helped keep alive the idea of Poland while the partitioning great powers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.